Welcome to this event. I'm going to hand straight over to Markus Greenwood, who is the CEO at Mind in Salford, who is going to give us a brief outline and introduction for this afternoon's event. So, Markus.
Hello, everybody, and welcome. Very nice to see you all here today. So welcome to the Northwest launch of the Mindful Nation UK all-party parliamentary report. It's fantastic to see you all here, and fantastic the sun's come out for us today to show Salford off in its best light. The Mindful Nation report provides an exciting and groundbreaking opportunity to influence the way in which we deliver healthcare, criminal justice, education, and the support and management of people in the workplace in the UK and beyond. John Kabat-Zinn, I'm sure he needs no introduction, says of the report, "It may be a singular and defining document addressing some of the most pressing problems of society at the very root, at the level of the human mind and heart." I couldn't have put it better myself. So today we're going to have some great speakers telling us about the exciting work that they're already doing across Greater Manchester and the northwest of England in the mindfulness field. And we've also got some people talking about their personal experience, their personal journeys of using mindfulness. And we're lucky to have Jamie Bristow here from the Mindfulness Initiative, who's been doing the great work with the all-party parliamentary group to produce the report, and he'll be presenting the findings of the report later on with a Q&A as well, so you can ask your questions. And then the second part of the afternoon, we'll be looking at the challenges of implementing the recommendations from the Mindful Nation report. So like I said, it's wonderful to have you all here in our stomping ground of Salford, to discuss a subject that I'm really passionate about and that's really close to my heart and has really helped me on my personal journey as well. So it just remains for me to wish you all an engaging, an informative, and most of all, an enjoyable afternoon. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Markus, for that introduction to set the scene for the afternoon. I'd like to welcome our first keynote speaker, Taravandana Lupson, who is from both a clinical and managerial background with the NHS and is now an organisational development consultant and mindfulness teacher, co-leading the Leadership Mindfulness Programme for the King's Fund.
Thank you very much for asking me to be here, and thank you very much to Breathworks. I feel quite indebted to Breathworks on a personal and a professional level. Thank you. So I'm going to just talk to us very quickly to set the scene about what is mindfulness, so what about mindfulness, and then I'm going to tell you a story of one leader or two, depending on the time. So what is it? Some of you will know this. You'll have a snappy definition. Anyway, here's one of many definitions that exist that I particularly like. So in the first instance, mindfulness is about being aware right now of how we think, how we're feeling, and what we're doing. And it's also about being with this experience rather than having to do anything about it and avoiding the tendency to respond on autopilot and feed the problem, if there is a problem. And C, it's about creating a gap between experience and our reaction to it, which means we've got more choice. So what mindfulness training is about is mind training. It's a bit like having a gym for the brain and the emotions as well. So mindfulness training consists of tools and exercises that build the capacity and capability of the brain. And that means that it can have a potential impact on anyone with a brain. That means, as well as if they do it. It doesn't work, does it, if you go to the gym and you don't do anything and you just sit in the coffee bar and have a coffee. You have to do something. And that means it can work for people at all levels of organisations, whoever they are. So why should we be bothered about this? Well, I can't really do justice to the research, and we're going to hear about the impact on many people today. But fundamentally, mindfulness training helps people to be happier and healthier. It enhances well-being and relationships. In an organisation, it results in more energised, more engaged, and a resilient workforce. It reduces sickness absence. In one study, it reduced sickness absence by 55%. It reduces presenteeism. It also makes people who are in leadership roles more effective, more emotionally intelligent, and that means that they make better decisions, they engage their teams, and they're able to better navigate complex systems. Also, at a fundamental and personal and organisational level, it's an effective way to manage stress, depression, pain, and impact on chronic illness and addiction in a very positive way. So I'll let you look at this slide yourselves in your handouts. But I just want to tell you about a programme I'm involved with. So I work with the King's Fund, and they are well known for running leadership programmes for very senior people, particularly in the public sector, NHS, local authorities, etc. And we run a programme at the King's Fund that the clientele who come are people like chief execs, GPs, matrons, executive directors. And it runs over four modules in the countryside somewhere, over 4 months. And at its core is the classic 8-week mindfulness course. And in fact, in this instance, it's the Breathworks 8-week mindfulness course. And then what we look at is how can you apply what you've learnt and how it's changed your brain to your leadership role. And we enable people, support people to embed a practice in their lives, doing their exercises regularly, daily, and we support them through things like mentoring. And the programme has a profound effect on the participants. And here is the story of one senior leader. So this person is a very senior commissioning lead in a commissioning care group and in a GP practice. So Jim's leadership practices have changed from being controlling to being able to come from a far more compassionate place through empathy, understanding, listening with fascination and asking inquisitive questions. From my heart rather than just from my head. And I'm more able to connect with people. He described being more attentive in his behaviours, able to take pauses, not uncomfortable with silence. And being able to use mindfulness to support people. And that's, after all, what leadership is all about. It feels easier, lot less pressured, because people are more engaged, they own the problems, they're motivated and they want and feel involved. That's the impact on one leader. It's a way we think of changing the NHS for the better. Thanks very much. I could say a lot more. And I'll just leave you with this quotation from the person from where mindfulness originated a very long time ago. With mindfulness, let's strive on. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Taravandana, for that enlightening and inspiring keynote. I'd now like to welcome Ruth Passman, our second keynote speaker. Ruth is the Deputy Director of Equality and Health Inequalities for NHS England.
Great to be here, really nice to see everybody. And it's just wonderful to be here for the launch. I try and work on the principle of asking forgiveness, not permission, and I think I've probably already done the wrong thing and sat in the wrong place. I think we were supposed to be together, Taravandana, but anyway, it'll all work out, I'm sure. I'm going to touch upon a little bit today, a really quite piece of work that changed my life, really, and it was commissioning the first Department of Health proof of concept pilot around mindfulness and work preparedness. It involved exploring the benefits of mindfulness training for people facing a range of life challenges, and that doesn't do it justice. The people who were on the course will stick to their designated 60 seconds or so of telling you exactly what that means. They can tell that story better than I can, and I'll ask a couple of them to join me in a moment. But basically, the evaluation report indicates anticipated significant improvements alongside the ones that are mentioned around kind of securing employment, but real improvements in people helping identify their core life values, their sense of purpose and direction, promoting their awareness of their natural resilience to stress, recovery from adverse life events, and also adopting mindful approaches for when they join the world of work, which, as we all know, they'd really need in the world of work. Some real key success factors in this pilot were co-production, ongoing mentoring relationships and support networks, and the kind of expert by experience approach to community participation and leadership, and building respect and working throughout the programme to maintain equity between the professionals and the course participants. And then following that training and the significant number of people who found employment, one of the interesting things happened was that on the kind of final day we had this kind of bespoke course around getting back to work, and we sort of said, right, okay, who wants to stack shelves in Tesco's, who wants to be a care worker, who wants to be an actor, you know, and 18 people said, and this was totally left field, no, didn't see this coming at all, we actually want to be mindfulness teachers. So we kind of think, what do we do now, you know? And we actually managed to then actually commission mindfulness training with Breathworks, and we've got a cohort of 12, 13, including a couple of supportive professionals, about 15 people who went through that training course, and really changing the face of mindfulness teaching, in my opinion, for the best. Very quickly, what does mindfulness mean to me? Well, through that pilot, it absolutely changed my life, really, in a number of ways. Obviously, the usual ways, what mindfulness brings to us. But I think in terms of that kind of confidence to be authentic in what's a fairly formal role, what was in the Department of Health and now in NHS England, I probably suffered from what a lot of senior leaders suffer from, which is this imposter syndrome. You know, I felt I was always pretending I was a civil servant, and eventually I was going to be discovered that I'm really not, you know. And I learned to actually just be myself and not worry too much about, you know, these labels and formalities that are placed upon us. Keeping it real, one of my colleagues from the course has just joined. I think I can see Natasha there. And Stuart, hopefully somewhere. Dave's going to come up in a minute, just to talk very briefly about how this course really indicated that mindfulness doesn't have to be monocultural, it doesn't have to be exclusive or class-bound. For me, that's really important. In terms of the policy agenda, you know, you know about the evidence base, you know as much as we do around that, so I'm not going to dwell on that for long, except to say that obviously we all know there's been a huge rise in application of mindfulness to the workplace. I suppose my caveat there is good work is good for our health, poor work, zero rated hours, contracts, you know, work for people who have low levels of control and job security isn't good for us. So I think we've got to watch that as it comes up the mindfulness agenda, that we're not kind of, mindfulness isn't being used to kind of justify some quite poor practices. Mindfulness has huge applications in the world of health. Obviously, we know the kind of efficacy around prevention of depression relapse, but I think it's got a massive application in terms of compassion, person-centered care, dignity, and moving away from warehousing models of care to relational care. I think that, for me, is really important. Also, in terms of supporting the mindfulness, the healthcare workforce, Borman talked about the invisible patients, the healthcare workforce. How can needy staff meet the needs of needy patients? So you've got people working in high-demand caring roles. Mindfulness, if it's introduced appropriately and it's kind of real mindfulness training and support, can really make a difference in that respect. Okay. So I think for me, it's about who's mindfulness. It's about changing professional culture. It's about bringing together. If we're going to actually transform health and social care, we can't keep on doing what we've always done and keep on imposing models of care that don't work and that are dreamt up by some policy geek like me who has not got a clue about the lives of the people who they're kind of developing the policies for, quite frankly. We need to co-design and co-deliver with the people who are recipients of the care, and we can look to the mental health recovery movement and the addiction recovery movement for some really good practice in that respect. In terms of mindful leadership, I'd just like to flag up that we, you know, if we're really talking about true leadership, we need to talk also about the people who came through the pilot course who have now become mindfulness teachers. They're people with lived experience of gang and gun crime, the prison system, the care system, the asylum and detention system. They've been through drug dealing, drug addiction, and through to become community leaders. And that's really important. And for me, are we ready to put those practices and those teachers at the centre of mindfulness teaching in the Northwest? That's going to take more than goodwill. That's going to take some real systemic change. So I'm going to, without any further ado, ask, who from the pilot is in the room? Anybody can stand up or wave a hand at us. We've got Dave. Do you want to all come up and just say a few words? I promise we'll finish the time. Miraculously, it's going to happen. It really is. Dave, over to you.
Hi, I'm David. I'm on page 15 in your books, by the way. I was a case study. Just to promote myself.
Page 50.
Yes, I did say page 50. I've clipped all the 80 other pages. I was in recovery. I was in a very violent criminal dealer and served 18 years in prison. The first time I came across it was when the NHS did a study. And I thought, well, yes, buddy centre, I'll go there, have a laugh, see what this is about. So I went to the buddy centre, and the first 3 minutes breath, follow your breath, I thought, why, where's it going? So, and then I just listened to him and everything, and then they asked questions afterwards, and I thought, well, do you get anything out of that? I said, no, not really. I just heard you talking and going on. But then I realised that all I was thinking about was what he was talking about. And that was the first time in my life where my mind has actually gone, doofed. Because to shut me up is unbelievable. It was just going on and on and on. You know, like, I've got to do this, got to go that. What time is it now? Has he finished me? No, what's she saying? I've got to do this. But then I thought, wow, that's the first time my mind's been at peace. And that immediately got me. That really got me on there. And then from there, I travelled on to be able to open the whole world of learning. So I used to walk around Manchester and just my head down and everything. Now I started looking up. Now I'm mad for architecture. I'm looking, wow, and that's building in there. I've lived in Manchester like 59 years of born. I'm looking up, wow. The world just opened up. Education, they said I was dyslexic and this, that and the other. Proved them all wrong, did every test. I'm now a consultant and researcher at Manchester University on CBT prison, you know, the cognitive behavioural therapy in prisons, and helping with that for the last 5-6 years. I'm also a member of the EDC. Simon Stevens is the chair on that one. I'm a Manchester Values Group member. I've done more in the community. I still live in Colliers, North Manchester, which is it's my community. It's okay. And people, I clean the community, I talk to people. And it's all through mindfulness. The anger issues have gone. You know, sometimes it brings its head up again. I just say to my mate say to me, I just go a bit red-faced, David, breathe. And I just sit back and just say, okay, and breathe for a minute. And that is it. But mindfulness, I've really got to say, it's absolutely the best thing that's ever come. If you could put it in a drug and bottle it up and give that, I'd tell them. You know, it's just absolutely, it educates you. It gives me so much joy. And it really controls my life. And now I've got chronic vein disease, I've got hepatitis, I've got this, I've got that, I've got all kinds of things. But the mindfulness helps me just deal with it. Don't cure it, but I'm here, I'm alive, I'm going strong, you know. So that's really mindfulness. It's got to be at the roots. It's got to start in the schools and finish in the jails. And that's me. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dan.
Hello there, my name's Sam Stewart. I was on the pilot as well, along with David and Ruth. My story is pretty similar to David's, but I'll tell you about the aspects of how mindfulness changed it for me. I mean, I went along just because it was something to do, to be honest. But when I got there, I realised, yeah, this is all right, this. Because I knew which direction I wanted to go, but I think mindfulness definitely helped me to focus. And with all the training and the courses I was going through, and being fresh in recovery, it's not always a bed of roses. It's not always an easy journey. So I think mindfulness helped me to concentrate on my training, looking for work, doing job interviews, that sort of thing. It brought me into the present moment in time rather than thinking about where am I going to be in 5 years or what I used to be like. And it just helped me to focus. And I'm convinced that over the years it's helped me in all the training and the courses I've done to get me to where I am now. And I'm also very lucky that I've worked in quite a few places in the last few years. And each place that I've worked, I've been very interested in the mindfulness that I've done. And they've asked me to bring it to the workplace. And I've worked for, like I said, four or five places. And where I'm working now at the moment, they've also asked me to bring mindfulness into my job. So I'm grateful for mindfulness and for actually going on that pilot and sticking through it. And I'm one of the ones who wanted to be a teacher. And like exactly the same as David, it's definitely changed my life because recovery is not an easy journey. And it's definitely helped me to focus, keep myself centred, and relax me, and help me to deal with what life throws at you. Because like being in drug abuse for 20 years, living on the streets, blah blah blah. I mean, it's a long story, but you get things that come up from your past all the time, especially when you're fresh in recovery, and they can knock you back and send you back down that route. But I think mindfulness has definitely helped me to deal with these problems and just get through them as best I could. And it's given me a positive outlook on life. And I definitely think it's helped me to get where I am today, which is a job I wanted to do over 10 years ago. And I finally got there last year. So I'm really grateful to it. And I'm going to keep on using it. I think it's really good. And like I said, it's helped my life.
Wonderful. Thank you very much, Ruth. Thank you very much for those personal experiences. Very inspiring to hear. So this takes us nicely into the first panel of speakers this afternoon, which is made up of key mindfulness organisations, researchers and case studies from the Northwest, which will help us set the scene for mindfulness in the region and see how this has been influencing both the national picture as well as the regional picture. So I'd first like to introduce Singhashri Gazmuri, who's the Programme Director from Breathworks.
Thank you. Well, hello. Nice to see you all here. I was very moved to hear from the last two speakers, so I'm just sitting with that, or standing with that. So yeah, it's nice to hear from you, Ruth, as well about the impact that the pilot had. This is a really exciting time for Breathworks. We've been offering mindfulness programs for over 15 years, and that's an expression of many of us who work at Breathworks are Buddhists, so it's an expression of our deep desire to help use the practices that we've benefited from to alleviate suffering in the world. Dr. Michael Dixon from the NHS Alliance said that the greatest future achievement in medicine will not be some new technological achievement, but if we can better support people to look after themselves. So this follows on quite nicely from what we've already been hearing. So just to say a bit about how big the problem is, particularly with people with long-term health conditions and chronic pain. So about 50% of people with long-term conditions report moderate or extreme pain, and that rises to 80% of people with three or more conditions. Chronic pain itself is considered a long-term condition in its own right. Chronic pain affects about 1 in 5 people in Europe and 1.5 billion worldwide. So just imagine the next time you're on a train, how many people sitting around you might be in pain, whether it's visible or not. In the UK, that's 31% of men, 37% of women, or roughly 20 million people in this country alone. And 7.8 million of those suffering from moderate to severe pain has had that for 6 months or more. So just to say a bit about Vidyamala Birch, who started Breathworks, many of you will be familiar with her story. If you're not, I'd really like to encourage you to go to our website and hear more from her. She decided to start Breathworks as a way of sharing with the world what she'd learned herself after suffering for 30 years with severe back pain, and bringing meditation and mindfulness practices into relationship with that experience. So she drew on the work of Jon Kabat-Zinn and also on the meditation practices that she'd learned through practicing within the Taravandana Buddhist community, who some of you may have heard of. So she developed an 8-week course, which includes, first and foremost, an emphasis on the breath as an object of awareness, as a conduit to bring kindness and compassion into our felt experience in the body, and as a way to help us relieve tension and contraction in the body. So just invite you all to make a fist. Notice what's happened to your breath. Breathe into that fist. Imagine the breath going into that fist. What does the fist want to do? Open. So people with pain can do that. They can bring the breath into the body, into the space around the pain, and begin to help relieve tension and contraction. The program also includes a strong emphasis on kindness and compassion. To bring that sense of warmth, non-judgment, and the possibility of a different experience to the pain. A strong emphasis on mindfulness in daily life. So interestingly, pacing programs have been part of pain management for a long time, and Vidyamala quite brilliantly brought that in through a mindfulness lens, so bringing mindfulness in daily life to a traditional pacing program. And to date, just to say, there is no comparable mindfulness program out there in the UK designed specifically for people with long-term conditions and chronic pain. So we feel our work is quite important. So just to say a bit more about Breathworks, we have currently 150 trainers worldwide in about 20 countries, delivering courses to about 1,500 people per year. Now, I don't have any statistics on how many people that is since we started, but I'm thinking it's probably somewhere around the 10,000s. 10 to 15,000 people. We're also a proud member of the UK Network of Mindfulness Teacher Training Organizations, and we feel we bring a very unique perspective there because we're not an academic institution. We were started by salt of the earth people, just Buddhists who wanted to share what we knew with the world. And we're also really committed to making mindfulness as accessible as possible to people regardless of their socioeconomic status or disability. So as we know, mindfulness is not new. It comes from 2,500 years of Buddhist tradition. But luckily, science is finally catching up with that tradition. So now we have the science to back up what we already know about the power of the mind. So this moment in time is a unique opportunity to bring mindfulness to more and more people who otherwise would never have come across it, or maybe not would have been interested in it. So just to say a bit about where we start at Breathworks. So we start at the premise that people are ultimately whole and that mindfulness is about helping them to return to that wholeness, which is a radically different approach than modern medicine, which assumes that sick people are broken and need to be fixed. Vidyamala talks about this in her life story. She talks about getting to a pretty critical moment in her own journey where she was at the end of her rope, and she realized that up until then she'd been holding on to the idea that there was someone out there in a lab coat who was going to fix her, and that she was actually going to need to find a way to help herself, to support herself, to begin to manage her own condition and take her life back. So the health sector is now starting to catch up to this idea. So this is from a quote from the long-term conditions compendium of 2012. So frontline staff need to be supported to deliver more personalized care and to support people to understand their condition and feel more in control. This means changing part of their role from being expert fixers to becoming coaches and enablers, or co-designers. That was a lovely term. I love that, co-designers of their care. So how does mindfulness help? In the Breathworks program, mindfulness is about supporting people to accept their condition and their pain, stop denying the situation that they're in, and reduce any additional suffering that may be added to that pain. through added thoughts, emotions, habits. We found that the simple act of helping people to establish a foundation of awareness, awareness of their body, their environment, their thoughts, their feelings, can lead to life-changing outcomes. So when we ask participants to begin to turn towards their pain, they're often very afraid to do that. But time and time again, as we gently lead them on the journey, what they find is that it's not as bad as it first seems and doesn't have to dominate or be the whole of their experience. So as one participant put it, I looked at things in a very absolute way. So my pain was solid. My pain was everlasting. Through the course, I see that everything is always changing, and that includes my pain. That helps me. It gives me a life that is livable. So just to say a bit about how could that be, because it's quite counterintuitive to tell people in pain to start to turn towards and be with that pain in quite a direct way. We've learned a lot about pain in the last 50 years. It's now, the definition has gone way beyond just tissue damage in the body. It's now believed to involve the whole person, the mind, as well as the body. And it's influenced by many, many factors, including one's emotions, one's belief, the societal attitudes that one has grown up in, one's culture, one's past experiences, and the meaning that we give to that pain. So mindfulness supports us to address all of those factors, which are just not as important as the physical damage. And also interestingly, modern science is now showing us that our brains are quite pliable. So we've learned a lot about things like the negativity bias and neuroplasticity, which shows us that there's very, very simple things we can do. Is it David? David was saying he looked up and he saw the beauty of the buildings around him for the first time, and the whole world opened up. But we can do that. We can choose to open our world at any moment. We can choose to look up and take in the bright blue sky, take in the beauty of a flower. The old adage, stop and smell the roses. That is real. That is true. And that does change our brains if we keep doing that. It actually changes the neural pathways in our brain. So there are real things we can do on a day-to-day basis to change our brains, which means more choice in how we respond to our predicament, whatever it might be. So just to say a bit about one of the things we're committed to at Breathworks, which is about getting the word about mindfulness out to as many healthcare professionals as we can. So that doesn't necessarily mean training everyone, but even just educating people on what the benefits might be. And what we do find is people come along, we do 3-day events for health professionals, they come along, they want to know a bit, and then they do decide to train because they get hooked. They fall in love with mindfulness and they want to know more. So I'll just end with a quote from the report. Mindfulness invites a fundamental transformation of the patient-caregiver relationship into a collaborative, inquiring partnership. Mindfulness offers greater potential for positively transforming cultures of care. Thank you.
Thank you, Singhashri, for that very interesting insight into the work Breathworks does. Just before I welcome Markus from Mind forward, I think there will be a Q&A at the end of this first panel. So if you can be thinking of any questions you might like to direct towards the panel for about 10 to 12 minutes at the end of this session. So I'd like to welcome forward Markus, CEO from Mind in Salford. Thank you.
Hello again. Okay, so I'm from Mind in Salford, and we're quite little in comparison to other organisations here. But we're an independent, user-focused, local charity providing quality services to make a positive difference to the mental health of the people of Salford. We've got a large advocacy service in Salford and Prestwich. We do welfare rights and debt advice for people with mental health issues. And we've also got a flagship eco-therapies and mental well-being site in Lower Broughton in Salford as well, where people can come along and be part of a team running a commercial garden centre and improve their confidence and look at progression routes and what they want to do next with their lives, which is a really successful project. And we've also got a mindfulness-based interventions programme. So we provide group-based support that differs from the traditional drop-in services. So I came to Mind in Salford about 8 years ago, and having had my own mental health issues and also having facilitated mental health drop-ins, depression and anxiety, I wanted to do something a bit different. I thought, what can we do? 1 in 7 people in Salford are on antidepressants. What can we do that will make a difference to the lives of people in Salford? So I kind of took a bit of a punt, really. I didn't really know what I was doing that much, but I'd been doing mindfulness for about 4 or 5 years, and I'd seen the impact that it had on my own mental health and how much better I felt. So I kind of wanted to kind of bring that into the lives of the people using our services. So since 2011, we've been providing an average of 5 mindfulness for stress and mental health courses per year to people in Salford on a low income who are experiencing high levels of stress or mental health problems. And we've currently got 130 people on our waiting list, so demand far outstrips the provision that we can provide with the amounts of grants that we get in. We provide the 8-week courses, which is a hybrid of mindfulness-based stress reduction and MBCT, mindfulness-based cognitive therapy. And it seems a lot of organisations are going down that route now, Bangor, Exeter and Oxford Mindfulness Centres. And on the courses, people get CDs to do home practice, and they also get access to our online resource. It's an area, password-protected area on our website where people can download the practices, and it kind of creates a bit of a mindfulness community for people who've been on the courses as well. Just a little bit about our evaluations. So in 2015, over 5 courses, we did an evaluation, and 85% of attendees in 2015 had at least a 25% stress reduction, the mean average actually being 42% over the 8 weeks. So quite profound reductions in people's levels of stress over the 8-week course that we kind of couldn't quite believe ourselves when we first started doing it. But if we could bottle that, obviously, we'd be making lots of money. And we did some work with the IAP service in 2014 as well, providing IAP-specific courses for people on the IAP waiting list in Salford, or people who wanted a group-specific intervention on the IAP waiting list. And this was kind of evaluated by the IAP service, and it shows a correlation between, you can see using the GAD-7, the anxiety disorders scale, and the PHQ-9, the depression scale, you can see people's levels of distress and experience of those conditions coming down over the 8 weeks of the course. And a really fascinating sort of side effect of that course was that the people who attended the courses to administer the GAD-7 and the PHQ-9 from the IAP services reported their levels of stress reducing, and they noticed that when they went back to their teams, it kind of had a pervading atmosphere as well, that everyone's experience within the IAP team started to become more calm, and they were much calmer as a service as well. So a really fascinating kind of side effect. Other facets of our MBI programme, we deliver mindfulness for carers and young carers. And that's been an amazing sort of experience for the people involved. It's a really, it's great because it kind of brings in peer support. As well as people learning mindfulness, they're kind of having that normalizing experience of being able to talk to each other and support each other and realize they're not alone in their experiences of being carers. And we also did some work with young carers as well, which again was a really sort of enriching and fascinating experience. We kind of had to really adapt the course that we were delivering, along with Sue, who's on our panel today as well. And we came up with some really sort of interesting ways of keeping the attention of the people on the courses as well. So we did things like mindful walking on bubble wrap so that people could hear the things popping under their feet as they were going. And Sue devised an amazing sort of safe experiment with containers and cooking oil and paint, so people were creating their own lava lamps, but then we're getting them to engage their 5 senses while they were looking at the lava lamps and experiencing the lava lamps. So that was pretty cool. We've also recently done some mindfulness for carers of those with dementia. Again, a really interesting kind of project that we did there. And not only did people bring down their own stress levels, so they also were much more able to relate in a positive way to the people they were caring for with dementia. And interestingly, they tried some mindfulness with the people they were caring for and had some quite interesting outcomes for that people were more able to be in the present moment, even just for a little while. So that's something we kind of want to explore more, and I know there's some interesting research just come out around that. We do mindfulness for resilience in the workplace. We've worked with Oxfam, when they were going through a big change management recently, so providing a series of 14 lunchtime sessions, again with great sort of impact on people's levels of stress, and being able to relate to each other while they were going through the difficult experiences of change and reorder in their organisation. And we teach mindfulness as well. We've got a mindfulness teacher training, 1 year supervised pathway, which is in line with the recommendations from the UK Network Mindfulness Teacher Training. And also we're developing a mindful app at the moment. So that was originally developed to use for people who were coming on our courses, but it's going to be available on the Apple Store soon as well, so we're going to get the message of mindfulness out there to more and more people. And we're also working with another Mind in the UK, at City and Hackney Mind. You've got quite a big mindfulness programme. I know Mia's here today from City and Hackney Mind. I'm working in partnership with National Mind, a three-way partnership, to look at rolling out mindfulness-based interventions to the 145 local minds nationally, the ones that want to have a mindfulness provision. And kind of a lot of train-the-trainer stuff, sort of, and with the developing teacher training offer that we've got at the moment. So that's a really interesting proposition. We're also kind of doing some blue light resilience work as well with the police, fire, ambulance and search and rescue. We've got a bid in at the moment to provide more mindfulness and resilience-based interventions, because lots of people have work-related stress, as you can imagine, in those areas. And looking at also putting some money into developing our mindfulness app, so it's specifically for blue light services as well, so that people have something on hand that they can actually work with on a daily basis when they're experiencing some really difficult situations. We also have monthly drop-ins for people who've been on our courses, so people come along once a month. All our courses are free to access, and so are our drop-ins as well, so people can come along, keep their mindfulness going. If they've kind of fallen off the wagon a little bit, they can come and share their experiences with other people, and keep their mindfulness practice going. And we hear some fantastic stories, really, about people's experiences of how mindfulness has changed their lives. And we've got an 8-strong mindfulness team, and we all go home at the end of the day thinking, God, what kind of job can you do where you get to hear that kind of feedback from people, that the interventions that you've supported have changed people's lives? So really powerful stuff. And lastly, I'm going to talk about the users of our services, which are the most important people. We encourage and support people who attend our courses to develop their skills further. And we've so far funded 4 users of our services to complete mindfulness teacher training, and they're now delivering courses for us as well. And we anticipate this will grow as well. Now we deliver our own mindfulness teacher training in-house. We can put as many people as we like onto that and encourage people who show a passion and aptitude for mindfulness to be able to get involved and take it further. And then finally, we ask people who come in our courses to just give a quote, really, what they would say to somebody who's thinking about coming on one of our courses. And a lady we worked with recently, her quote was, "I've been ill for years, now I know I can get better, and importantly, I know how to do it." And that, for me, is kind of worth all the hard work that we put into our mindfulness programs, and just says it all for me, really, that people's experiences of coming on the courses in Salford are really quite profound, as I said before. And this lady kind of has continued to come to the drop-ins as well, and is really thriving. She's really sort of created a different relationship to her experience of her mental health issues, and she still has some of them going on, but she deals with them in a lot different way, and they don't affect her in the same way as they used to. So that's the work we're doing at Mind in Salford, really. Just our contact details, that if people want to get in touch, we've got a Q&A at the end of the session. But I'm happy to take emails and, you know, phone calls from people who are interested in our programme and what we're doing in Mind in Salford. And I'm also even more interested if people want to offer us money to continue our programmes as well, and commission us to provide more services. So thanks for listening.
Thank you. Thank you, Markus. Very interesting to hear about your work at Mind there. I'd like to welcome Geraldine Thomas now, who is the founder and director of Mindflow in the Northwest, who's going to talk to us about SEN and the National Autistic Society.
Hello, everybody. It's really good to be here. I've been looking forward to this event. Mindflow's been in existence for about 10 years now. I'm based in the Northwest. but it seems to be growing, so I seem to be all over the place. Part of the UK network, so we offer teacher training programs and the hybrid of MBSR and MBCT to clinical populations. But as my work has evolved and as the business has grown, I seem to be moving more and more into the school side, working with the children, teachers, and parents. And I'm going to give you a brief overview of the work that I'm doing in Kent, in the Helen Allison School in Kent. So the Helen Allison School is one of six National Autistic Societies of schools dotted all over the UK. And it is a residential school for children and young people with the diagnosis of autism spectrum disorder. So when I first was invited down to the school, it's evolving. Mindfulness is evolving, working with different client bases. So I thought this was a great opportunity to actually sort of embed myself within this group of very special people within the autistic spectrum disorder. That's how it's diagnosed, a disorder. But I don't particularly see it as a disorder when you're actually working with the children and seeing beyond the diagnosis to that human being. It's been an incredible sort of opportunity for me. So I thought I'd embrace this opportunity because I have been doing, and Ken Harrison will be talking to you about that next, I have been doing a project with Knowsley Borough Council under the Head Start project, a National Lottery funded project. And I've been working in a school in Knowsley, and it was a special school. So the children within that school had a variety of extra special needs. And one class in particular, there was a high percentage of children with autism. So I'd actually gone in there and delivered a program, and it worked very well. So when this opportunity came up, I thought, great, go and see how it works. So what I had developed with Ken in Highton was a whole school approach, whereby you go in, you teach the children, you teach the parents, you teach the children, but also you teach the community as well. So it's not just a whole school approach, it extends further, because the parents that came to the parents group, they were also active members in the community. So we really saw this interrelated approach as quite a key way of working with mindfulness, of embedding it in different sectors. So the students at the Helen Allison School, the students I'm working with range in age from 5 to 17. And we work in situ within their year groups. And due to the complexities of some of these groups, there's a high level of support staff present. So in one group, I have three children, and each one of the children has to have a support worker. So the adults and the children within the group, we all sit in the group and we're all participating in the group. So it's not that the support staff or the teachers are sitting outside observing, they're very much part of the group. And that's what I bring that's what I was going to say insist, but I don't like that word. But that's part of the programme, that adults are in the group with the children, and that's how the group works and evolves. So the complexities of the children that I'm working with range from the general anxieties related to autism to students who are selective non-verbal students, pre-verbal students, as well as students with minimal communication skills. And I find it incredible to actually be working with these children and teaching their mindfulness and to actually see how they are starting to work, to understand mindfulness. I mean, week five now, I can just go into the group and we sit straight away and we do a practice. So it's amazing, sort of an unfolding process that is going on in this school. So these children as well, in addition to these complexities with autism, some of the students access CAMS also with issues relating to self-harm and eating disorders. So there's a wide spectrum here that I'm working with in the school. So as I said, the pilot that we did in Heighton, I'm doing the same model down at the Helen Allison School. So alongside the children and young people undertaking the groups, I've set up a program for the teachers, for the staff, and for their own well-being, but also for them to get an experiential understanding of what mindfulness actually is. Lots of people, you know, mindfulness is very much a buzzword at the minute. So people have heard about it, but some people don't really understand from an experiential point of view what it is. So I thought this was quite important. The teachers group. And again, I'm in parallel with this, I'm running a parents and carers group. And this has proven to be very beneficial. One parent said to me that she's noticed how her way of relating towards her child has started to change. And due to this, her child has started to change in relation to her. And this was very, I had a lot of feedback about this change in relationship when you're in the flow of difficulty. And I had this feedback from the work that I did in Heighton. So clearly showing this interrelated approach. Because when I go into schools, I say quite clearly that it's not a behavioural management programme. It's a programme of... we're all part of the programme and we're all working in a related way. So, for example, a teacher or a parent might start to notice what's coming up in them in relation to their child. And due to this, they are able to change, make a choice in that moment. And this is just a really interesting process to observe. So I'm just going to finish to say it has been a huge privilege and very humbling for me to be working with these children and young people with such complexities and lifelong challenges. And it gives me great hope and heart to actually see the potential that mindfulness does have to go out there and reach different people by just touching that human connection in us all, looking beyond and just touching within. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. I'd like to now ask Tim Duerden to come up. Tim Duerden is Senior Lecturer in Counselling and Psychotherapy Chief at the University of Salford.
Well, thank you so much, James, and the folk organising this, for the opportunity to speak about some of the work we're doing. I think the word that Geraldine just used there about privilege is something I'd kind of really like to share, is a sense of privilege that myself, my colleagues that I teach mindfulness with, have had in terms of working with people in various situations, particularly in Salford and in Manchester in general, where we've been working with people who have tended to perhaps fall outside the scope of where perhaps the more established approaches to teaching mindfulness to people may lie. And I wanted to share some of kind of the learning really we've experienced through working with people in this way. And in particular, I think it's useful just highlighting out of the Mindful Nation report this notion that there are some barriers to accessing mindfulness that have been very helpfully identified in the report. So we've got some quotes here from the report. In particular, innovation is required to address the economic and social barriers which prevent access to mindfulness, which some members of the panel have already been speaking about. Generally speaking, the participants on mindfulness-based courses do not currently represent the range of socioeconomic and ethnic diversities within the UK. And the programmes need to be adapted to accommodate different levels of literacy, communication, comprehension, ability and access to technology, which, for instance, both Geraldine and Markus have been talking about their work, kind of helping this happen. The approach that myself and my colleagues have been developing is one we call Mindful Resilience Enhancement, to add yet another set of abbreviations to the alphabet soup of ones out there. And what we've been kind of exploring really over about 15 years is how do you offer mindfulness in contexts where maybe people might not immediately feel able to engage with mindfulness in their life situations. And in particular, that's been in primary care, community and educational settings. So for instance, at the Christie Hospital, we've been working, exploring how to help people who, for instance, might be just there for one day or maybe different days of different days of the week over a short period of time. How do you offer a meaningful program of mindfulness to people who have quite erratic or complicated life situations? So that's been working with people at the Christie. Service use at the Willow Tree and the Big Life Company were really important for us a number of years back in terms of exploring having the privilege, using that word again, of working with people who felt safe enough to say, well, this aspect of what you're doing has been really helpful in terms of learning mindfulness, but that bit, not getting that, or that didn't seem to fit. So really the word that Ruth was saying, this kind of co-development of mindfulness in a context that really learning from the people we're working with to get their sense of how this could be helpful in their lives and integrating those learnings into our approaches. We've been working a lot with service users and trainers at Blue Sky and Trafford, staff and students at the University of Salford, and also what's been really wonderful is kind of having shared experience coming back from people who've done our training. So for instance, people at Dolden Mind, Blue Sky, Start 2, Macmillan, etc. So there's this sense of kind of co-evolving an approach to offering mindfulness. I think it's worth maybe just kind of noting some of the barriers that may kind of emerge for people if they are wanting to engage in what may be seen as more established approaches to mindfulness teaching, such as mindfulness-based cognitive therapy and mindfulness-based stress reduction. And in particular, I think there's people who would find the 8-week commitment to doing a course just immediately feels impossible. We've worked with people who actually would struggle to know what they're doing in a month's time, let alone 8 weeks, and so can feel that to actually commit to that length of time is impossible, or may at least seem impossible. And also people who, when they may understand that part of the kind of invitation to start a mindfulness training such as MBSC, MBCT or MBSR that might include being willing to practice half an hour, 45 minutes a day, then the thought of doing that can seem impossible for many people. I think it's often quite interesting just to pause and kind of reflect on our own experience. If we're in the middle of quite busy periods of life, what happens to our emotional system, to our body, if we say, right, I'm going to find that 45 minutes every day, if that's kind of a new to you. And often you might notice a tensing or an oh my God, or crikey, how's that going to happen? So it's quite a big ask for some people to even begin to think about that. Similarly, there can be people who have quite a low distress tolerance. So things out of the ordinary that they're not familiar with can quite quickly lead to spikes of quite strong emotional agitation. And so doing longer practices, such as half an hour, 45 minute practices, for some people can be a context in which they don't have the resources to sort of self-soothe and be resilient as they experience what might be quite a new situation. And I think what's been really important as well is exploring the fact that many people have pre-existing experiences of failure or shame in social context or learning context. And so people can be set up to be really very anxious about the thought of, am I going to enter a situation where I'm going to be seen to fail again? And so how do we help create a safe environment for people to learn mindfulness who may have very strong aversion to contexts where they might be seen to fail? So some of the things we've been exploring with our CANI colleagues and the people who've been so fortunate to work with in terms of people coming on the courses is, how do we explore establishing the practices, the practice of mindfulness in the context of what people are doing anyway? So can we look into people's existing daily routines and do and explore how to lay down the principles of learning mindfulness within what you're doing anyway? So for instance, how can we become quite systematic in using experiences like the feeling of water on the body as we shower, or the walk from one place to another? And I think these are often seen as the kind of informal parts of many approaches to teaching mindfulness, or the focus on mindfulness in daily life. I think what we've been really interested in doing is how to have these at the heart of people's initial experience of mindfulness as a starting point. So that fits into starting a teaching course with very short practices, some moments of practice to capture what happens to our attention. And as people become familiar with a sense of what mindfulness might be, to then be increasing both the duration and the frequency of the practice people do. I think also, how do we, and I think this is a real challenge to any kind of system which is seeking to offer a systematic way of cultivating a particular approach such as mindfulness, how can we be kind of flexible in what we do so that the framework of the course is adapting to the people we're working with, rather than requiring the people we're working with to adapt to a specific framework? And I think that's a big challenge that we're not saying we've got kind of answers to that, but it's a particular area of kind of focus, I think, that's important. And finally, kind of creating this sense of a learning environment that minimises this risk of failure, especially at the start of the course, where people may not feel they have the resources to notice with mindfulness and kindness to self, look, I'm struggling here, I'm feeling like I'm getting this wrong. How do we create a place where that isn't so dominant for people that they choose to disengage from the mindfulness course? And a kind of overall kind of approach that we try to infuse into the courses we run is this notion that mindfulness is something you just can't get it wrong. And the kind of feeling people can have when you explore this sense of what kind of happens inwardly, if you say, you're on a course here and you won't be able to get this wrong, is the kind of message. And that sense of people when they start saying, I thought I got it wrong, but actually I'm realising this was another part of my experience to be mindful of. So I think I'll leave it with that.
Thank you, Tim. Thank you. Tim. I'd like to welcome Ken Harrison, who is Head of Communities at Knowsley Borough Council.
Okay, thank you very much, and thank you for the opportunity of coming here, being invited here today to just share with you some of the work that we've been doing in Knowsley over the past, it's probably 18 months to 2 years now, around the Head Start Knowsley initiative, which is a big lottery funded project. We're in the second phase of the project at the moment, which was a £700,000 phase two project, which is around building the emotional and mental well-being of young people, 10 to 16 year olds. And we're one of 12 local authority areas across the country to be fortunate enough to be working alongside the Big Lottery Fund in terms of, and what's been nice about this phase two is they've titled it a test and learn phase, which I thought was really good because we don't really know what we was going to get out of it. We were encouraged to try something different. And that actually, it's just a little bit like we were saying before about mindfulness in that sense, that we couldn't fail. There was no such thing as failure. It was actually, be brave, do something different. And that sort of, that message that was given out by Big Lottery to us actually changed our mindsets in terms of, well, how do we approach mindfulness within the context of Knowsley and doing something slightly different. So we've just coming out of phase two, and we're moving into the phase three part of the project, which we will be putting another bid together in order to roll the programme out across the borough over the next 5 years. But the mission for the programme was to raise the levels of emotional well-being and resilience in young people by providing opportunities to develop and grow socially and emotionally. And we saw that really as being able, an opportunity to give young people the skills. It was a, like we said, it was a skills-based programme rather than a programme where we was just doing lots of activity with young people. And we developed that through our sort of empowering communities approach, which was, we took the view that lots of things get pushed through schools. As soon as you mention young people, that it has to go through schools. Yet the relationship that young people have might not always be a very positive one in school. It might not be a positive one at home, and it might not be a positive one in the community. But you know what? Somewhere along the line, within them three environments, a young person will have somebody who they can talk to, somebody who they can work with. So we wanted it also to be a move away from intervention to creating a more preventative culture. So not waiting while somebody became ill, but actually working with lots of young people and their parents in terms of whilst they're in a good emotional state. So the approach that we've taken is, and Geraldine referred to it about being an interrelational approach. The parent, the community, the teacher, with the child or the young person at the heart of the programme. So we've run mindfulness courses for the children in school, for the parents of the children in school, for the teachers of the children in school, but also with our community members as well. And what we found was that where the parents were supporting the child to carry on the mindfulness practice at home, and when the teacher was supporting the child in the classroom with mindfulness activities, there was a real shift in performance and in terms of emotional well-being of the young person. The programme was Stop Gap Go, which was developed by Geraldine Thomas of Mindflow. And I've just got a few little sort of snippets, really. This young boy, we went down to the school to see how things were going. Took a number of people down there. And this young boy, he said, I really used to, you know, struggle with my number work. And I'm okay now. So the teacher said, explain a little bit more. So he said, well, I used to get really angry when I couldn't do my numbers. He says, and now I do the stop, gap, go basically he meant he stopped. He recognised he was feeling angry, improved, and also his in the classroom, his anger has reduced tremendously. With the parents group, it was interesting when we went down to speak to the parents how much emotional frustration that the parents were carrying. Not only one parent said, not only the frustration of actually sometimes having children with learning difficulties in the family, but also just life in general. And they said, actually coming on the mindfulness course gave them an opportunity to take a break. And some of these things, actually, when you sat there and you're listening, you know, they're so big for, you know, big issues for people who are really busy and have got complicated lives, that we sometimes miss that that's actually a real value, that just actually being able to go somewhere and take a break. And this was, so forming relationships was another big part of the process. And I just want to just read Claire's story to you. Claire said, my son has been on a high level of medication to still his compulsive fear of being alone. He needs this medication to sleep at night. He is taking part in the program and has developed greater self-awareness. We are always doing the mindfulness practice together. It is wonderful. He always wants to eat mindfully and constantly talks about the potato in the animation. This program has been a wonderful shared experience. It has taught me to take time for myself and not to feel guilty, and as many of us mothers with children with special needs often do. My son has now had his medication significantly reduced, and I am convinced it is due to this program. We do lots of measures, and I think we need to, and you know what, all the measures that we've done, they all showed an improvement. I think there's got to become a time when we start to move away from keep measuring and actually look towards some of the value that the programs, mindfulness programs, can bring to individuals on a very personal basis in terms of how it affects their lives. Mm. Working with the communities has been interesting. It's been challenging. It's been very rewarding. We had three community groups who have been part of many government initiatives over the years. New Deals for Communities, SRB programs, which has created tension. It's created competitiveness. It's created a learnt helplessness in many cases. Being involved in community development for over the past 10 years, I can honestly say that this programme of introducing mindfulness has been the best bit of community development work we've ever done. It's brought community groups together, they're sharing experiences, and they're working in a more compassionate way, and also delivering mindfulness activities to the young people who come into the centres. So just to finish off, and just to draw some conclusions, the greatest improvements were evidenced where we saw the parent, child and teacher working together. Children say they feel calmer. Parents feel better to cope with home and life situations. Teachers are reporting happier school environments, and community leaders have become stronger. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, Ken. Now I'd like to ask Yogesh Patel to come forward, who is a teacher at Urmston Grammar School in Manchester.
Thank you very much. As you said, I'm a teacher at Urmston Grammar in Trafford, very much at the start of the mindful journey. So I completed the 8-week mindfulness course. I carried on my 6-month meditative practice. And just in August, I did completed a four-day course to allow me to teach mindfulness to pupils. So we're in the process of implementing that within the school. I was invited initially just to talk about my experience of mindfulness. I came across it quite by chance, with an open mind though. And I think that was the main thing, that I was just curious to learn about it, really. And that sort of translated to the pupils I came across. For me, personally, I think it's helped me respond to situations. And I know these are cliches, and every time you talk to people talking about mindfulness, they're very quickly backed up with research. There's lots of research here. But I think anecdotes are important as well. So the case studies were very relevant and very interesting, I thought. So me personally, I think it's allowed me to respond to situations a bit more calmly, a bit more considered, in a more considered way. I'm more adaptable to situations within a classroom context. And I think I'm more receptive to situations which I'm not entirely happy about. This is both from the pupil's point of view and with colleagues within school. And it's something which is perceptible from the pupil's point of view as well. So they do comment that actually, oh, right. Whereas before you'd have done this, you're listening. I think that the phrase they come up with, oh, I feel heard, which is quite interesting from the young person's point of view. Having sort of witnessed it within a classroom environment, and we're at the very early stages of implementing mindfulness within school. I'm entirely convinced that it's good for the children. I think it's good for their resilience. They're more in control of their emotions, and it's something that they already have. So we don't have to teach them anything. We just have to show them how to use these tools, which they're already born with. I think that was the key thing. And touching on one of the points there, it's something you can't fail at. You just, with practice, you get better at. And this in an era of league tables, tests, and everything else, I think pupils in schools are very aware of the fact that they're being judged all the time. So this was a complete revelation to a lot of the pupils I came across, where I said, you can join in or not, it's your case, and let's just do a practice together, which they're initially skeptical about, but once they actually saw it working, they wanted to do more of. And I think from my direct experience with children, what I find is they're a lot more open-minded than adults, firstly. So as soon as you start talking to adults, the first thing is, well, where's the research? What backs it up? Whereas most children would listen to you, and they're very happy to do it once they see it work for them. I think that was the key thing. So you introduce them to these tools, made it accessible to them, and you just watch them grow and flourish, actually. So I think that was a key point for, as I said, I'm not really part of this August group here, but I'm very much at the start of this journey. And from the little I've seen, it's startling just how much of an impact it can have on kids. I mean, there are various stories and various anecdotes. There's one, this is before I started my mindfulness, and I'm sure this teacher wasn't a mindful teacher. She was just a very good teacher. She was a year ahead. I was doing a register. It was the end of lunch. And a young pupil had been pushed down some steps, had a grazed knee, bleeding, and crying, quite rightly, so the pupil was in pain. This was the head of year, so she'd taken him into into the office, sat him down, and she carried on with her paperwork. And initially, I thought she was just ignoring the pupil. I thought, that's a bit strange. I carried on doing my register. My classroom was next door. And then when she had finished doing whatever she was doing, she sort of turned back to him and said, right, it wasn't you they pushed. You just happened to be in the wrong place at the wrong time. And when she said that, the crying stopped. And I almost felt a dawning on the pupil occurring over the pupil. So previously, when he felt like a victim, it was always him being picked on. It was always him being pushed down the stairs. Now he came across as if, oh, just happened to be stood in the wrong place. I'm still bleeding. I have to get that fixed. But I'm not the victim here. And it was quite an interesting thing to witness, actually, because what came across to me was that it was the same reality. The reality hadn't changed. It was just how that person, that young person, perceived the reality. Whereas before, they're always a victim. They're always being pushed down. And it wasn't the case. And when that was highlighted to the pupil, it instantly stopped, which I thought was quite powerful. So as I said, I'm just at the beginning of this mindful journey. I think there's a lot in it. There's a lot in it for me to learn. And I'm just at the start of this journey, which I look forward to carrying on with. So thank you for that.
Thank you. The next person actually isn't up on the stage, Colette Power. Welcome, Colette. Colette's a Breathworks teacher and trainer based in Liverpool and North West, and is going to talk to us about the role of mindfulness in her own management of anxiety and depression. Thank you.
Thanks. Hi. So I've taught many mindfulness-based courses over the last 5 or 6 years for people who've experienced stress or felt pretty hopeless, or who've run out of tricks really to lighten their mood and their load. And one of the things that I've that they flagged up in the sessions that I've been part of is how useful it is for them to be in an environment where one human being is candid and shares their experiences of anxiety or depression, their experiences of vulnerability and being human. And it's an honour to be part of that process. So in that vein, I'm going to extend that practice, which I think is practice, and share some the ways I've managed my own anxiety and depression over the last 3 decades. So I've experienced I don't need to see that. Yeah. Thanks, Taravandana. So I've managed my symptoms of anxiety for about 3 decades, and the way I managed it, if you could call it management, was to fight it. I didn't accept that I didn't want those symptoms and those complications, and I didn't want to be that person. So the way I met my experience was very, very brittle and defended, and ultimately exhausting to not accept who you are, and for there to be no softness or understanding or space for those experiences. So the pattern of fighting continued until I was exhausted. And in a funny way, depression allowed me to stop. It allowed me to step out of busyness and to step out of trying to be good and better in order, I suspect, to be loved. I think that was the thing that drew me on. So there was that cycle, and Vidya Marla talks about it in the Mindfulness of Health course, the boom and bust cycle, and she relates it to the way that we manage pain, but it can be equally related to the way that we manage mental events and emotions. So that cycle of anxiety and depression went on for some years. And the treatment was pretty standard antidepressants or psychotherapeutic interventions, and they were useful, very useful at the time for me, and I've tried pretty much a range of different approaches. I think one of the things about psychotherapeutic interventions, and I see the echo of it in mindfulness courses, is that contact with another human being who has time and space, and that can be very healing relationally. We're hardwired, so they say, to connect. And it seems that increasingly we're independent, but that can also mean that we're lonely and we're isolated, and that can impact on mental health issues as well. So that was very useful. And mindfulness is great, isn't it? Because I just ran mindfulness alongside psychotherapeutic interventions and at one time pharmaceutical interventions. So it kind of, mindfulness is an and approach rather than an either or. But we don't have a therapist with us all the time, or at least I couldn't afford to have one with me all the time. So the skills that I've learned from mindfulness, they're mine. I go on my 8-week course, I might throw £200 at it. But when I come away, I have those skills and they're integrated into my life. And I can run with those skills, I can extend them and deepen my practice. So once upon a time I had anxiety, depression and my GP who was helpful or not, and now I have whatever I have in my life, anxiety, depression, and I have my practice as well. So it serves as an anchor in a world that is very changeable for me. So perhaps one of the most crucial things that I learned from mindfulness, and I take this into my teaching, is an understanding of the power of awareness, the development of awareness, this fundamental aspect of mindfulness. So without awareness, I cannot see the constellation of thoughts that arise in my mind, those thoughts that are very difficult, that may be very critical or harsh, that leads to a lowering in my mood. I can't see that pattern. Once I can see it, then I can act compassionately. I can tap into my resources with the development of awareness. So I need to be able to see what's happening for me in terms of my thoughts, emotions, and physical sensations. I need that ability. I can't change what I can't see. And that's a continual practice for me to deepen my sense of awareness. And once I can see what's happening, oh, lots of difficult thoughts today, lots of tightness in the chest or the belly or whatever the constellation of sensations are, then I can respond with kindness. So I didn't learn a skill set of being kind to myself when I was very young. I just didn't learn that. So, but mindfulness has given me an ability later in life to pick that thread up. It's one of the reasons I trained with Breathworks, because I saw the word compassion and I thought, oh, and my whole body responded to the word because I knew I needed that more than anything. So kindness in relation to anxiety and depression is key, because I think a lot of the problems for me have been with inner critic and being very harsh with myself. So yeah, just to emphasise that aspect of kindness that warms awareness up, so that awareness has arms that holds all of us, all that, those self-critical aspects of us and the difficult experiences that we have. So just to outline the main culprits for me in terms of anxiety and depression, thoughts, really clear awareness of thoughts, what kind of thoughts are happening, particularly when you're stressed, particularly critical thoughts, the absence of kindness, the absence of that in the makeup of an individual, and to include that, modelling that as a teacher, or including that in the curriculum of the course. And also a broader understanding of the nature of suffering. I used to think I suffered because I was unlucky, or because I just couldn't get it together. I didn't really understand that that all human beings suffer, and that to a degree that it's what connects us. So when we sit in that classroom together and we listen to each other's experience, we tap into some beautiful common humanity. And I see people's shoulders relax. I see people breathe. I think see them exhale, to understand that that's part of being human. Tara Brach says, everyone relax. We're all human, every last one of us. So for me, my experience of anxiety and depression and teaching mindfulness leads me to that conclusion of my own humanity. And those courses that I run, they create the space for us to be fully human together and to learn those skills of kindness and awareness and understanding the value of common humanity. So I practice for my own benefit, but I also practice for the benefit of others. Just in terms of one aspect of my own practice, I move towards the difficult. It's deeply difficult, and it's deeply difficult because it's recurrent and repetitive. So as we know, mindfulness isn't that magic wand, is it, that we wave and it makes it okay. So for me, anxiety and depression is recurrent. But to have those practices that enable me to work with it over time and to work with that edge. So if I get moved towards my difficult edge, I know what that means in a classroom to ask another human being to do that. For how long? For when is that okay? So to use my practice to guide my own teaching. So for me, as a long-term sufferer of anxiety and depression, making mindfulness more accessible in terms of support and well-being and mental health. It's a joy to see that happening.
Thank you very much. Next, I'd like to ask Sylvia Daniels to come forward, who is a carer in Salford. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. I just want to talk a little bit about mindfulness from the personal experience. I've not got any technical information for you or anything, specialised facts or figures, just how it's affected myself. I was introduced to mindfulness through a course that was actually run from the Salford carers about 2 years ago. I'm the prime carer for my son, who was diagnosed with autistic spectrum disorder about 8 years old, specifically Asperger's syndrome. He's also suffered with quite a lot of illness and bad health during his early years, and he was diagnosed with cancer when he was 11, which was quite a hurdle to get over. I was invited to attend a course of mindfulness during a time when I was at a really low ebb. I was stressed, feeling very low and lost, and very, very over emotional all the time. So I signed on for it happily, hoping it would help. I've always used forms of self-help techniques in the past when I've tried to help with stress that's been caused from various sources. I've actually trained and qualified in reflexology, and I've trained with Reiki, and the reflexology does help physically, not only for myself and members of the family, but colleagues and people that I've met along the way. But I never really found anything to lift my mood emotionally, unfortunately. Mindfulness, however, was very different to any other things I'd tried. It felt extremely therapeutic to me, even in the very early stages of the course. It was an 8-week course, but by week 3, I was absolutely sold on it. It was very easy to follow, to engage with. It felt very natural, delivered by very, very comfortable surroundings and easygoing people. And it was very accessible any time that I chose to apply it to myself out of the course. It's had a really great impact on my feeling of well-being virtually straight away. It's brilliant for me. It's been the best feel-good approach to mood that I've ever tried or encountered. It gives me relaxation. It gives me stress-free time. It enables me to energise myself when I'm feeling low. And it gives me the ability to reassess problems and therefore gain a better sense of optimism. I'm quite a pessimistic person by nature, unfortunately, but I do find doing the mindfulness practice just allows me to be a lovely person, and it's nice to sort of get out of the formed opinion of 60 years of what I think I am to what I actually feel inside that I've denied myself for a long time. I can rely on it totally because I know it works for me, and I indulge as often as I'm able to. I'm not as good as I should be for my own benefit because I have quite a stressful life. But I do indulge when I can and as often as I can. For me, it's been like a great big safety net, a bit like feeling to a bit of extra money in the bank. It's something to fall back on all the time, and it never lets me down. It's been amazing to me how something so easy and simplistic to learn has had such a real dramatic effect on me as a human being. I was so full of the good feeling that it gave me after I'd completed the course that I was trying to get everybody to go on a mindfulness course, whether they felt they needed to or not, really, because it's such a massive effect, a good effect. It's like having your first glass of wine when you're stressed. It's like having your cigarette or whatever, you know, rocks your boat, really. My elder son's a bit nervy and agitated, and he was having a bit of a hard time at work during the period just after I'd finished my course. And I actually even managed, against his will, being only 23 at the time, I thought it was all poo-poo, to get him to go on a course. And he actually went on the course and agreed it was a real turnabout for him. And I would just implore anybody that, you know, is interested to give it a whirl, because it's so easy to get into and it's so beneficial for very little input, really. And that's all I've got to say, really, because, as I say, I'm just looking at it from a person that went along on a course. I'm always keen to try different things, because if you're all, you know, if you've constantly got stress in your life or you've got problems in your life, you know, you need to keep going and you need to be on top. And sometimes you can feel very alone and lonely when you've got the most of the responsibility on yourself to try and sort, especially in my case, support and help my son. I'm, you know, foremost a mum and a carer and a wife. But it is an added burden when you've got the physical and emotional well-being of somebody very dear to you on your shoulders. That, for me, mindfulness has helped me 100%. Thanks for listening.
Thank you very much, Steve. That was a very personal account, very inspiring. I'd like to welcome Sue Feasey, who's the last person on this first part of the afternoon's panel, to come forward. Sue was a course participant at Mind in Salford and is now a mindfulness teacher there. So, thank you.
This glass of water. I've been very mindful of this for the last hour and a half, balancing there. I'm just going to pop that down because I'm only short. I'm just going to talk to you about my mindfulness journey. It began many years ago when I was in my 30s, when I decided to take an open university degree. I'd left school with no qualifications and wanted to see if I could get a degree. It took me 6 years whilst working full-time at the University of Manchester and bringing up 3 young children. So I used to get up at 5 o'clock in the morning to study before getting the children ready for school. And obviously coming home from work and getting them ready for bed and everything else. And this continued for 6 years. I did come out with an honours degree in psychology, which I was very proud of. And at the time I thought I'd coped really well. But now I realise at that time I'd been sowing the seed of a tiny plant that I'm calling my worry plant. Because I've been worrying about not having enough time to get everything done, I worried about the children, about work, about getting essays in on time. And as I said, this had gone on for 6 years. But then moving on to the next stage of my life, I became a primary teacher. I worked endless hours. I worked from 7:30 in the morning until 6 o'clock at night when they threw me out of school. And then I continued working at home in the evenings and at weekends. I enjoyed being a teacher and I did a good job. But by now, I was germinating the seed of my worry plant and it began to grow roots and shoots. And by this stage of my life, my mood began to change. I wasn't sleeping. I'd lay awake until 4 o'clock in the morning and then have to get up 6:30 for work. I was irritable, angry a lot of the time, crying a lot of the time, and I'd started to get palpitations and they were coming on more and more frequently. My worry plant was developing extremely well by this time and was now in a full-grown tree with very deep roots. I worried about the planning, assessment, report writing, being observed, what I'd got to do, what I'd already done, what I'd said, what other people had said. But teaching isn't all doom and gloom, it has its good points too. One day, myself and a colleague took 60 children on a school trip to Manchester. First we went on the big wheel, and then it was followed by a trip to Manchester Art Gallery. So we had a lovely day, but as you might imagine, it was very stressful. Especially at the point in the art gallery when we were all gathered on the ground floor, and I just happened to glance to my right, just caught sight of one of the children in my class who was waving to me as she was going up in the glass lift. So by now, my worry tree was doing marvellously. It had grown lots of babies and it turned into a huge forest. So one day I was at the having a great day out with the children, but the next day I ended up in A&E having a suspected heart attack. And I had all the classic symptoms, pains across my chest, I couldn't breathe, pins and needles. Fortunately, I hadn't had a heart attack, but it was a warning. I'd pushed myself too far. And from that day on, my life changed dramatically. I developed really severe palpitations that went on for lengthy periods of time, for hours at a time. And I started suffering with dizziness, something I'd never had before, which was quite debilitating. I couldn't go out and I couldn't understand what was wrong with me. And I was off work for a very long time with these symptoms. And after going many, many tests for the dizziness, I was told by a neurologist that I was suffering with anxiety, which was brought on by work-related stress. But I was also suffering with depression. And I didn't believe the neurologist about the dizziness because I wasn't anxious. I got on with things, and I always had. And it was several weeks after seeing him before I began to acknowledge that he might actually be right. Shortly after this, I was offered the opportunity of attending a mindfulness course with Mind and Salford, the 8-week course. When I was first told about the course, I was told it was something about sitting and noticing your breathing for 15 minutes. So as you can imagine, I felt really enthused by this. One of my initial reactions was, I haven't got time to spare to sit and notice my breathing for 15 minutes. And this was because I'd always been in that mindset of being a time as an issue. I've got to do this, I've got to do this, I've got to do this. But I decided to give it a go anyway because I thought, what have I got to lose? And I'd heard really good reports about it. But little did I know that this would turn my life around. I still hadn't accepted that I was depressed and I wouldn't take medication offered by my doctor. I'd never noticed a sensation of anxiety in my stomach before. This was before mindfulness. I'd never realised that my breathing was shallow. I never realised I was holding my breath. So this was the first time that I'd noticed what my body was doing. When I first did the kindness to self practice, I actually broke down in tears because at that point I realised that I had forgotten how to be kind to myself. And it was only through sitting and paying attention to what my body was doing that I could begin to fix it. And over the 8 weeks, I managed to make a little clearing in the forest, just enough so that I could see the light coming through the trees. And after the mindfulness course, I expressed an interest in teaching mindfulness. Initially, because I was actually interested in teaching it in schools, but that now I realise that it needs to be a whole school approach, and so you know I couldn't do that at that time. But Mind in Salford asked me if I was interested in doing a teacher training course, and they paid for me to attend the Mindflow course in Liverpool that Geraldine delivers. That was in 2013, and I've been teaching mindfulness ever since with Mind in Salford. Since then, and helping many more people to turn their lives around. And gradually over time, I've managed to clear the forest, but now and again, another tiny seed germinates. But the difference is now, with mindfulness, I notice the seed before it grows into a tree. Mm-hmm. So thank you for listening to my story.
Thank you very much, Sue. Okay, so it's time for the Q&A now. We are running a little bit behind schedule, but it's very difficult to want to interrupt some really inspiring and positive stories. So we'd allowed about 10 to 15 minutes for this, but I think we need to make it more about 5 to 7 minutes because there is a second Q&A in the second section. Singhashri, Gazmuri is going to facilitate this. If you do have a question, put your hand up, and if it's for anyone specific, please say so. If not, we can direct it.
Okay, so there's a hand in the back there. So James is going to come to you with the mic so we can all hear you.
Hi, I've got a question for Markus and Ken, actually. It's almost exactly the same question, but it's really to help me understand what these mindfulness interventions actually are, because it sounds like there are a number of different ways of delivering this. So, for example, Markus, you talked about the IAP study that you delivered during the waiting period where depression came down. self-reported depression came down, self-reported anxiety came down. But I'm actually quite interested to know what was the kind of intervention that you actually delivered. Was it a mix of things, or was it one thing, or if the things that you delivered was one thing more effective than the other? So I'm really quite interested just to get the feel for what it is that you did. And similarly, Ken, with regard to that amazing thing about stopgap go and the vignette about the little boy who broke the pattern of anger and did his work better. What is stopgap go? So that's my question, really. Thank you.
Should I go first? In answer to your question, we were delivering the 8-week standardized program, which was a hybrid of mindfulness-based stress reduction and mindfulness-based cognitive therapy. But as is often the case with the courses we deliver, sometimes the structure goes out the window and we respond to what the people's needs are there and then sort of thing. So if people say they can't sit down and do a 30-minute practice, then we work with them and look at how they can do an abridged version or something shorter that is a gateway into perhaps doing longer practices eventually. So it's very much an adaptable course, a kind of flexible course that works with what people's needs are there and then in that present moment, I guess. And we do obviously have the course structure, but we're not sort of like hell-bent on delivering that no matter what. We're responding to what people are actually telling us about their experiences and what works for them as well. So, and I think we're going to talk about that later in the sort of challenges section as well. So,
okay. With the work that we've been doing with Stopgap Go, that's a product, a mindfulness approach that Geraldine has developed, and I think it would probably be better if Geraldine says a few words about what Stopgap Go is. But what I would like to say is that for me, and what was really interesting was around when we started to talk to the community, communities in particular, they wanted to introduce mindfulness as into activity. So they were very keen at bringing mindfulness into art type work or exercise or around the environment. And Geraldine's been doing some work with them to explore, and it's around that co-design. I think sticking rigidly to an 8-week program where you've got an interest and where you've got people who want to explore and develop it further, go with it, you know, and see where it takes you. And that's that little bit about being brave in terms of how we use mindfulness so it becomes in our everyday lives and way of being. But if Geraldine wants to say a few words about the programme.
Yeah, the Stopgap Go, it is an 8-week programme that I take into schools, but this is a small little practice. And the reason I developed that is to actually develop a positive habit to enable people to step off and steady themselves. So it's very visual. It's just a traffic light sequence, but the gap, the yellow is a larger circle, because when we actually do stop, we turn our attention to the breath or other anchors that we use, we actually start to create that space, that gap, which opens up to enable us to steady ourselves and then to actually move forward. So that's a short little stopgap go practice for children, you know, adults or whatever, just to become aware of when they are becoming stressed or there's anxiety or they're nervous. And then just in that moment, it's that visual representation of actually stop, take a breath, make some space until you come back and re-engage with what you need to engage with. Does that answer your question?
That's great, absolutely. Thank
okay.
you very much.
Great, we have a question here in the front.
Hi, my name's Shad Woolgrove. I've tentatively and very kind of cautiously ventured over the Pennines from Sheffield. And my question's to Tim. Are you aware of what you are doing, whether that's happening anywhere else in any other schools of nursing around the UK?
I think the answer is yes, but it tends to be quite patchy. So I think the particular thing we're doing within the School of Nursing at Salford is offering a series of 2-hour brief interventions around kind of easily accessible mindfulness skills in years 1, 2, and 3 of some of the nursing programs, the midwifery programs, but also within our counseling psychotherapy programs. And kind of versions of that are happening in quite a few different university training courses, professional courses around the country, but I think it's just quite patchy. It's often just coincidental. There happens to be someone there who's got an interest and something begins to develop from that. That's probably all I can say on that. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Tim. We have room for one more question. I think there was a hand. Okay.
Really quick. Trevor MacFarlane from the European Parliament. I came a bit further than in the Pennines this morning. This has been a great event. Thanks for all the people that shared their stories in particular. I think it's really brave and it's made me think about my own mindfulness, which is really important. I had a question about creative arts. I was really struck by the things that we're talking about. Quite often creative artists do instinctively. Mm. It's part of their practice. And so my question was around how you can connect with people that are already doing this kind of work in a way that's maybe, dare I use the word, sexier, more interesting than an 8-hour course where one has to sit down and participate in maybe your programmes. Does that make sense?
Who'd like to take that question?
Can I say something briefly on that? I know the Manchester Museum Service, both Manchester Art Gallery, Manchester Museum, Manchester Whitworth Gallery, they've been very actively developing some of their community engagement workers to be trained up to deliver mindfulness, and are doing fantastically innovative mindfulness kind of teaching as a kind of first taster, where they'll do a mindful walk around the art gallery, pausing to look at paintings, weaving a mindfulness practice into that kind of situation, really to just plant those seeds of whether this is something possible for people to pursue further. And there's also a program called Start 2 in Manchester Mental Health Service, which sadly is being closed down thanks to the cutbacks, but that has a very long track record now of weaving mindfulness into art-based therapy. So people coming as part of primary and secondary mental health referrals onto that course, where they're using, like saying, kind of sexy, kind of creative ways to engage in mindfulness that offer a very safe vehicle into people developing resilience and skills in terms of their own well-being. And there's also a colleague of mine who does mindful bread making. Whenever she talks about it, suddenly the interest goes, oh, mindful bread making, which probably is a way forward with that as well.
And I'd just like to say we're sort of developing with one of our mindfulness teachers who's a really a great photographer. So we're going to be doing some mindful photography courses up at our Garden Needs Centre. And again, that's about trying to develop gateways into mindfulness that aren't always the traditional gateways, but ones that people might more readily engage with. So.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.